Could you explain your role in the Kansas City, Missouri School District during the years between 1971 and 1997?
I came to the district in 1979, and I had many roles in the district. I started out as a teacher of English and journalism. Then I was a special education teacher, and during my time as a special education teacher, one of the ways that I worked with my students was going to the teacher's lounge and informally talking to the teachers about my students. And for some strange reason, the teachers thought that I was an administrator, even though I was a special education teacher, because I would give them strategies for working with my students. Also during that time, I was taking classes over here at UMKC, and I wrote a paper in which I outlined a position called coordinator of instruction, which was an administrative position. It was a person whose job was, person was totally in charge of the instructional program, and it included planning staff development sessions for teachers and evaluating teachers. Also, a friend of mine developed a program called School Within a School, and I became one of the first coordinators of that program. It was a challenge for me, and I loved it. I took 100 of the students who were supposed to have been the lower performing students, the lowest performing students in the school, and I had I worked with four other teachers. We planned their instructional program for them. We separated them from the school. Those students made remarkable gains because we had all of the instruction was thematic. We planned, all the teachers planned units together. We did everything together for the students. In working with those students, somehow or another, word got out about our group of students at Southwest High School. It got out to the U.S. News Today, and they sent someone to my classroom to observe the group for a day. And at the end of the day, they asked me, how did I get so lucky to choose the top students in the school? And I had to laugh because these were students that no other teacher wanted. They were behavior problems. I mean, that's what the teacher said. They were behavior problems, and they were troublemakers, and they could not learn. Those students could learn, and that was one of my most memorable experiences in the district during this period of time. This was a busy, busy, busy time. I was excited because we had money. We could get, and risk-taking was encouraged. You know, people were encouraged to plan, implement lessons that were outside the box, that kind of thing. And that was right up my alley. I got a chance to travel. I worked with teachers and administrators all over the country. It was really, really exciting. There were, of course, we worked on planning the schools to fit the themes of the magnet themes. There were meetings with parents, with students, community leaders, all of that. It was just excitement. There were teams of teachers who went out recruiting students. I believe that during this period of time, the teachers in Kansas City, Missouri had probably the best staff development that existed in the country. There was a lot of collaboration with this university. Their activities where the kids came over to the university and worked with the professors. It was really, really a wonderful time. However, some of the themes were not as attractive as other things. And it was not as easy to, our plan was based on bringing white kids into our schools. And that's kind of a one way of integrating the schools. For example, at King, you were never going to get enough students to come to the Latin grammar theme to really integrate that school. Now, they had one of the principals that they had at King. There were some ugly things done, and I probably shouldn't address this, but it's the truth. To show that we were being integrated, the white kids that came were put on one particular team. And so when guests came in, it looked like there was real integration going on. I had a friend who wanted her son to come to my school because I was there. And when she came to visit, she observed all of the teams, and then she saw the one that was integrated. And she wanted her son to be on that team. I'm not going to go into the ugliness that followed that, but you get the picture of some of the things that went on during this period. Also, during this period of time, I think one of the questions is coming up is how did the parents and the community, the kids, view view all this? And at first, the parents and the kids were excited about it. But then some of the, they soon found out that it wasn't exactly designed for them because they could not necessarily go to the schools that they wanted to go to. And a lot of the kids, the schools who lived in the neighborhoods for certain magnet schools could not go there because if you had to audition for the school and you didn't make it, you could not go. And so that was a downside of the way that we did, we integrated in during that time period. I think the staff was excited about it, and everybody put their best feet forward. They wanted to, everybody became a recruiter for the district. We wanted our district to just seem like we were the best. There was a lot of reading going on. I'm a reader, and so I was really, really happy. There was a lot of reading, a lot of study groups We studied, I remember one body of research was the effective schools research. We studied all of that, and people were discussing. We were just, we really were learning communities. Everybody was excited about this. We got, we were able to write plans for our schools and then hire people who carried out our special programs. I mean, for the first time ever, we had funds to do with what we wanted to. And then I was excited because we had what was called a desegregation. I think this is the first time I've thought of this in years, desegregation monitoring committee. A lot of people did not care for them, but I love them because they stressed not only the learning outcomes for the students, but there was a lot of value put on intelligent staff. I remember that I had an interview for a job, and one of the persons who interviewed me, Dr. Eugene Eubanks, he was kind of impressed by my my transcripts. And that's the first time that those kinds of things had been emphasized to in the hiring process, because I used to look at some of the people who were in administrative positions and wondered how they got those positions. But Dr. Eubanks paid close attention to that kind of thing, and I was excited about that. I think the students' attitude toward integration itself, I'm not necessarily talking about the process that we went through in Kansas City, but their attitude toward it, they loved it. They got a chance to socialize with people who were not like them. You know, a lot of the kids who lived in the city never went, you know, beyond maybe 10 or 15 blocks out of their neighborhood. And this was good for them. And it was good for the kids who came into the district. I think that was probably one of the most valuable components of this integration process, was the way that the kids saw it. You saw, and I know in my school and with the kids and teachers that I worked with, we did a lot of group work, which gave the kids an opportunity to interact really intimately with people of different backgrounds. And that was so valuable. I did a little unit in one of my classes that was on music, because I noticed that black kids thought they liked one kind of music, the white kids liked another kind of music, and of course the black kids weren't that tolerant of the white kind of music, and so I wasn't a language arts teacher, but I did a music unit where we looked at the themes from different songs and the words, and I had the kids work together writing songs. They loved it, and they came to appreciate each other. It was a wonderful time in many respects. I really don't like to pat myself on the back that much, but in any situation, I feel like, I made major contributions. First of all, I give everything my all in all. I studied. I developed plans to get the kids to work together. I worked on units. I worked with other teachers. And I think that every place that I worked in was better because I was there. And I've heard parents and teachers and students say that. I was looking through some of the things that were left over from that period in my house. I had thrown away most of the stuff, but I came across a thick pile of letters. And those were letters that students were writing to try to keep me at Westport Middle School. During this time, there was a lot. I was not a principal yet. I was a vice principal, but I was an interim, became an interim principal for a certain period of time when the district tried an experiment and brought, they brought a superintendent in from the Missouri City Schools. I won't call his name, but he was the principal at one of, at school I worked at. And I really did make his life better while he was there. And so when he left, they made me interim principal. And but then there was a lot of political stuff going on. The job wasn't permanent, and a person who was downtown at the time saw that my school had grown because, and I knew it was because I was there, so she wanted the principalship, and she got it. But I just ran across this stack of letters, and the kids were advocating for me to stay there. I did not ask for this. Well, I don't think that the academic outcomes that we wanted for our kids were different. We always expected excellence. During the first part of this period, I remember that a lot of emphasis was put on, and this is the first time I've thought about this, on the kids passing this test. They called it the BEST. And it was nothing. Anybody could, if you worked hard on this test, you could get your kids to pass it with flying colors. And then, of course, we did get the scores up on that, and the test was changed, and I think it was changed to the MAP, which was a little bit better. More thinking and writing involved in the MAP. It was a better test. But you had emphasis on literacy, which was good, and write up one of the things that I really did like. There was a strong emphasis on math and science. I don't think that we saw much. I don't think that the effects of that period was lasting because when you have neighborhoods that are all one color or whatever, it's kind of hard to recruit enough people into that neighborhood to really integrate schools. You had, of course, you had white flight, and it was hard integrating the schools. Now, I do see a little hope for integration now because I finally moved into the city and I'm in the heart of the city now. And I see all kinds of, a lot of the neighborhoods, you're getting people of all races moving back into the neighborhoods. There, for instance, on my street, when I moved on the street, there were only three viable houses. Now there are six of them, and three, the last three, have been inhabited by whites, and these are not upper class whites, they're like middle or lower, and they're coming in and they're taking these houses and they are doing enough to them to move into them. These aren't even people who are using them as investment properties. You have some people who are buying them as investment properties, but you have a lot of people moving into these houses. And I noticed, even at Central, when I went into the schools this past school year, you are getting a kind of natural integration now. And then downtown, you have lots of people, whites, moving in. You also have some of your middle-class blacks who had moved out coming back in. And there are charter schools, which are public schools, that are drawing people in. I think you're going to see some real integration now. I think the things that you've always needed, you needed people who care about these kids, people who believe that all kids can learn, and people who have strong sense of personal efficacy, that they can really make a difference with these kids. I don't think any of that has changed. Now, we have one little constant group of kids that remain. These are kids who their parents see themselves as powerless, and they don't fight anything. They just go to whatever school they're told to go to. They remain. So you have to have people who value all humans and who think that everybody can learn, because you do have a group of kids who don't have, and I witness this firsthand, don't have the structure and the support that we've had in the past.
Is there anything else you'd like to share with us about school integration in Kansas City?
No, except I'm kind of optimistic because I do see the city, I'm cautiously optimistic because I do see some changes going on in the city. But I also, as I see the positive changes happening in the city, I look at the immediate outlying areas and it seems like they're beginning to get their share of some of the things that we went through in the city.